Hello. My name is Nick Nicolescu, and I'm representing Forcepoint. In today's presentation, I will not go into product details, but I would like to introduce you to our new vision about security and how our portfolio is converging about, around this, this idea about risk-adaptive security. Well, first, a few words about Forcepoint. Forcepoint is a company, new name in the security landscape. It's a result of some mergers and acquisitions. So 3 years ago, Raytheon acquired WebSense, and then changed the name from WebSense to Forcepoint and make some other acquisitions. You will see at the end when I will present you our portfolio, which are the companies that were integrated in this company. So as part of Raytheon, we have a big focus and a big investment for Raytheon to become a leader of the security market. Why we talk about change and why we have this new philosophy about security, which we call human point system and risk adaptive security, is because we are facing a change in the IT landscape and security landscape. And the change is driven by what is happening today. So unlike traditional security, which was about confining systems in a defined area, now we have companies moving to cloud. Everybody's moving there. Sooner or later, all of you will be at least partially in the cloud. So Microsoft is pushing everybody to the cloud. Google is pushing, Salesforce, and businesses inside organization for business. If they go to cloud, they got agility, they got lower cost, they got flexibility. So unlike traditionally where you have your corporate network and your people accessing your resources, now not only you move to cloud, but there are different entities accessing the information and the system you need to protect. So everybody is opening the doors for partners, for customers, for suppliers, for authorities. So the system is no longer closed, and we think that traditional security cannot be applied in the new model. These are a few of the challenges that chief information security officers are facing. First is increasing of cloud application, as I told you. We are facing in the last 3 years 11 times increase of cloud usage. We have, and this is not only that there are many solutions, but one of the major issues in the today's security is the lack of human resources. Gartner was pointing out since 4 or 5 years ago that there is a big gap in the security market. Now the gap is even wider. GDPR is kicking in, so we see a lot of interest from companies to set up their security systems, to appoint DPOs, to start putting solutions to protect the citizens' data and whatever GDPR is requiring. And having a wide range of products, not only it's difficult from the administrative point of view, but requires specialized resources and many systems. Another big issue is the flooding of alerts. So many, as you increase the spectrum of security solutions, you are going to increase the number of alerts. And at one point it become impractical for a human being to make sense of the alerts. And just being flooded by them will decide not to do anything. We've seen in banks last year, millions and tens of millions of alerts every day coming to a team of 5, 10 people, which is not manageable. And another important aspect is the time to contain an attack. So after somebody discovers a breach, discovers an attack, it takes averagely 46 days to contain the attack after it occurs. Now, the traditional security works in two ways. It was a presentation in Greek before, but I understood from the images that it was the idea. So you have either the option to allow the good and say, I know this is good, I'm going to allow it. The rest, I'm going to block it. The other approach is to block the bad. So this is how an antivirus works. Identify a bad behavior, a bad code, a bad something, and it will block. Everything else will be allowed. These two technologies work in complementary, so you cannot have both. You have either allowing the good, other allowing the bad, and you will see after that there is a big chunk of activity, of cyber activity, internet activity that you cannot classify with accuracy. So if you decide to allow the good, then you will run into exception policy type of security, because obviously you don't know what is good from the beginning, and people will trying to do their jobs, systems trying to do the job, they will raise exceptions because they will be blocked because nobody thought that this particular action is good in an initial phase. If you block only what you know for sure is bad, then you open the door for bad things that you don't know they are bad, like zero-day attacks, like unknown attacks, like insiders, like malicious people inside the organization. So this is the lack of context, the part of activities where you cannot say it's good or bad, it's getting wider and wider. And this is not only about viruses and attacks, it's also about protecting information and deciding what people can do. And just to give you an example, if I have an access to a system in my organization and for 6 months I don't touch that application, but I have the right, I have the credential, the username and password, and after 6 months I start using it 20 times a day, is it good or is it bad? Usually the system will allow me. But maybe it's not me. Maybe somebody stole my credentials, discovered that I have access in that application and start using it. Maybe I'm getting rogue. Maybe I'm getting compromised. Maybe I'm doing something bad. Or maybe it's a malware in my computer acting in my name. So this is why we shift the approach and we introduce this new concept of behavior-centric security, which is risk-adaptive. And all our portfolio is converging in this direction. So, of course, you should always block what you know is bad. You should always allow what you know is good. But for the part that you don't know, you need to control the what you can control. And what you can control in the landscape I showed you before. You cannot control the borders. You cannot control the systems because they are, some of them belong to cloud owners. You can have your competitor living, in quotas, in the same server with you. So you cannot control the systems. You cannot control the borders because there are no borders. You cannot control who accesses it. Because if you say, yes, I control by username and password. Username and password is nothing. I mean, I've seen companies, I've seen banks, where in some departments, everybody knows everybody else's password. And this is in banks where you should expect that security is the highest level and nobody is doing such things. So password means nothing. Means that if somebody is accessing a cloud, using my password, all you can say is Nick was accessing this application at 1 o'clock in the morning from China. So this is what is happening with human beings. So the biggest problem in security is not what is happening with the systems, it's what is happening with people. And 81% of hacking-related exploits are exploiting compromised credentials. People make mistakes. Malware executes through impersonation. So if you get a malware, an advanced malware in your computer, then that malware will impersonate whoever is the user of that computer. And the people can be malicious as well. So you have different aspects where you have to make sense of what is happening. Is that people malicious? Are his credentials stolen or compromised? Is his colleague using his credentials to do the bad stuff and his own credentials to look good in the company? You don't know. And it's important, that's why it's important to understand the behavior of people, because as the IT landscape is changing, the people are the same. People are not changing, the infrastructure is changing, the way of delivering IT is changing, but people is the same, and also the data. So the data you want to protect and the people you want to protect and to analyze are staying the same. And these are the two constants, actually, in this landscape where you have cloud, where you have on-premise, where you have third-party suppliers, customers, partners, authorities entering in your systems. There are only two constants, it's the people, and it's the data. And this is the interaction between these people and the data that you need to see, to control, to see the behaviors and to discern whether this is a good or bad action. And we say this rhythm of the people and flow of the data. I will stop to this slide. I have only 2 minutes left. This is the portfolio of Forcepoint. These are products coming from WebSense, coming from Raytheon, coming from Intel, StoneSoft and Sidewinder as firewalls, coming from Imperva, Skyfence, and coming from Red Owl, the user and entity behavior analytics. And what these products have in common is not a single pane of glass. It's a real deep integration of the products. It's very easy to put, and we see companies saying single pane of glass. There are companies with 500 products in one management, but it doesn't mean anything. If one antivirus solution of a company can say about the DLP solution of the same company that is a virus, then even if they are in the same pane of glass, it doesn't make sense. We have, where it makes sense, we have a single management console, but doesn't make sense for UEBA, which is user and entity behavior analytics, and where you get access to extremely sensitive information to be managed from the same console where you manage the firewalls or when you manage the email security. What they have in common, the analytics layer, the management layer, and the orchestration between the solutions. And now a few words about each of the products. So each of the products is top of the line. Leaders in Gartner, or in NSS Labs, or in IDC. And coming from right to left, we have web and email security. This is coming from WebSense, including web DLP and email DLP. We have our DLP solution coming from WebSense and integrating also intelligence from Raytheon. Raytheon, besides money, they put some their high military-grade products into Forcepoint, the new created company. We have the Insider Threat, which is another product coming from Raytheon, and it's cooperating with the other solutions in order to decide whether a person sitting at a computer is that person or whether it's somebody else. So the system is able to identify by the way you're typing, by the way you move your mouse, if you are you, or if somebody is using your computer or credentials. Then we have the Cloud Access Security Broker, which is top of the line product, integrated with DLP, integrated with behavior analytics coming from Raytheon, and able to decide whether credentials in a cloud applications might be stolen or might be legitimate credentials. We have user and entity behavior analytics, and we have DataGuard. DataGuard is a new, not new, but newly released by the federal authorities to be sold in commercial market. It's an appliance designed to facilitate communication of data between air-gapped networks. So all these products are available, are ready. All the features are proven, are stable. We can organize demos, we can organize proof of concept if you want to see more details about the products. And now, since my time is up, I thank you for coming here.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.